Chair, any process? Open Chair was used in the process for a few years already. So some famous examples are the Open Chair transitions and Torsten's Open Chair canvas. But there's some new support and some changes that make it much easier to use it and to build with it. So the talk will cover more or less five topics. A short introduction, what is OpenShell? Then comments about platforms. Libraries that we use around OpenShell. How to use OpenShell in LibreOffice, and finally some features that use it already. And in the end, also a quick look into the future. So what is OpenShell? OpenShell is a cross-platform 3D API that in the current version is 4.5. I haven't even looked at anything 4.something. So we are stuck with something 3. Or even 2.something. There are more or less two different approaches. The first OpenShell versions, 1.0 until 1.5, use the fixed pipeline approach. That means that more or less the steps that OpenShell was following for getting from your data to something on the screen was fixed. And starting with OpenGL 2.0, they introduced a programmable pipeline where each step can be adjusted to the specific needs. And you can select some stages that are done and some others that are not being part. So how does it look? That's the structure of OpenGL 4.3. I didn't find it for OpenGL 4.5. But it's quite similar. You can forget everything about compute shaders. In LibreOffice, we use OpenCL for it. But you can also forget most of the other stuff. What we normally use is a vertex shader and a fragment shader. These ones are only available in OpenCL 4.0 and later. The other stuff is automatically done by the OpenGL driver. A shader, in this sense, is more or less a small small C-like program that's executed on the GPU instead of the CPU. The vertex shader gets input from you that tells it where each point in the world is, some additional input like transformations and so on, and it generates then the final position on the screen. The fragment shader then colors all the points or pixels on the screen that are in the rear of your triangle. So that was the GPU side, but on the CPU side, so on your application side, you normally work in buffers in modern OpenGL. Instead of more or less direct calls, you generate them, you fill them with some data, you bind them, and then pass them to OpenGL, the GPU side. Later you release them, you change the state of the OpenGL state machine. You set the OpenGL stuff up and put it in the correct state, and you select the correct OpenGL context. So the more difficult part with dealing OpenGL is the platform. OpenGL is cross-platform, so normally you would expect that you could just do the same stuff on all platforms. But OpenGL starts with an OpenGL context. So everything below that is not specified and is platform dependent. an OpenGL context is there more or less an object that tells the GPU, okay, these calls belong together and should be rendered to this window or this abstract platform-dependent object in a specific way. But how you get there is specified in, I think, four different platform or APIs: GLX for the X server, so mostly for us at the moment for Linux, WGL for Windows, CGL and NSOpenGL for Mac. So Mac has actually two different APIs, a low-level one that's not based on a window, rendering to a window, you have to do all of that yourself, and NSOpenGL, which works on a window and uses CGL as backend. We use all three at the moment for the different platforms that we support. EGL is the one that's used in Wayland, I think, and on Android. We are not using it yet. We have no support for it yet, but it can be easily added. All of these platform level stuff is abstracted in the OpenGL context class, where we create then an abstract an OpenGL context object that hides all these details from the user and is full of if there's to get the stuff. Paul?
How does OpenGL ES then apply to this?
OpenGL ES is just a different OpenGL version. So it's not a platform part. It's a subset of OpenGL calls that are allowed to. So you have the platform layer, that's GLX, WGL, CGL, and then you have on top of it either OpenGL itself or OpenGL ES, which is a subset of, I think, the 2.0 is for OpenGL 3, and OpenGL ES 3.0 is for OpenGL 4.2 or something like that, the mobile subset. So there are some problems with the different platform APIs. So Apple decided that it only supports OpenGL 2.1 or OpenGL 3.2, whereby they removed in OpenGL 3.2 the support for all deprecated features. So the fixed function pipeline that I mentioned that has been deprecated for years now is not available anymore. And in OpenGL 2.1, many of the newer features are just not available yet. So you have to more or less select which version you want to support. So it also means for us at the moment that we have to choose between the two for our code. So for old code, 2.1, and for new code, more or less go with 3.2. On Linux, we have many old systems. So I asked on the mailing list once for people sending out their GLX info, which gives you the information which extensions are supported, which OpenGL version is supported, which GLX version is supported. And there are surprisingly many people who still use OpenGL, or only have hardware and drivers that are able to support OpenGL 1.4 and or OpenGL 2.1. So the problem there, the best support is only available, so OpenGL 4.something is only available with proprietary drivers, and the current Visa version only supports 3.3. So even the one that's in current Fedora or something like that. And on Windows, you don't have support for rendering with or binding a context to multiple threads. So you have to make sure that your thread is reset before you use it in another thread. So dealing with OpenGL is quite hard if you do it directly. If you don't abstract it, you can only use the OpenGL version that's supported on your build platform. You do a lot of matrix operations, vector operations. And of course, you want some support for that. So we use two libraries, Glue, the OpenGL extension render. It abstracts loading the function pointers for OpenGL calls and does that at once instead of you doing it manually before you use them. But it only works after you have a working OpenGL context. So for all the calls that you need before the context is loaded, you need to load them manually. It helps with extensions, OpenGL features, OpenGL versions, because you have a variable that says if the extension or version is there or not, and you just check, make it an if instead of an if dev, which would result in a build time dependency instead of a runtime dependency. It's quite easy to use it. The build system, use it as put it into external libraries and include the Glue header instead of the normal OpenGL header, which then does all the work for you. Also, OpenGL context initialize Glue when you create the context. The other one is GLM, it's OpenGL Mathematics. It's used by quite a few projects. It's a header-only template library that provides vector and matrix operations. It therefore helps you with all your model transformations, view transformations, all that stuff that we have to some degree in base GFX. But the advantage is that it's layout compatible with GLSL. Shading language used by OpenGL. It implements many more algorithms than we have. It's better tested, well maintained, and we can replace a huge part of our base GFX code with GLM. I already did it for the OpenGL transitions, and it was quite straightforward. So, how do you use OpenGL now in LibreOffice? As I mentioned, you need to decide on a version that you want to support in your first step. So a 2.1 legacy context or a 3.2 core context. The OpenGL context class has a flag to tell it, okay, I want a legacy context. Change the makefile, you need to include Glue, GLM normally, and the OpenGL frameworks, they are platform dependent. And you need a pointer to your parent window, because OpenGL only renders to Windows, and a context is normally bound to a window. Exception is Mac, where the whole system uses OpenGL, but yeah. If we want to support a feature on our platforms, we need a window for it. Then you create your OpenGL context. It needs either a window pointer or a system child window. There are some cases where it makes sense to create the system child window itself. If you don't pass a system child window, it will create one itself. Where it finally gets a handle for the system for the real window provided by the system. I think Tamash's stuff uses that because it needs a special system child window. It then creates a platform-dependent context that is hidden mostly from you. At the beginning of your OpenGL code, you need to make the context count. So there's a make count method. It tells the OpenGL code, okay, use this context now for the following calls. And make sure that your code is only ever run in one stringer.
Thread.
So if your context might be used in multiple threads, you need to unbind it at the end of your calls. If you have one of these at the moment that's used in two threads, and you have to be really careful or everything can go wrong. So it's totally undefined behavior. On Linux it runs fine, but suddenly it breaks on Mac or Windows and can even kill your graphic card driver. So then comes the next step. If you decide on a 3.2 core context, you should read the chart2 OpenGL readme deprecated, where I documented all the OpenGL features that you should not use in a 3.2 context, because they are not available on the Mac. Read existing shader code. Shader code is at the moment in chart2 OpenGL, slideshow OpenGL, and I think canvas OpenGL. It's quite helpful to read existing code. Many of the existing problems are already solved. Might just be able to reuse it. At installation time, they end up in instdir program OpenGL. So all of them end up there and will be loaded during runtime from there. A quite helpful class is OpenGL Helper, where I extracted all the helpful OpenGL code, like loading a shader, compiling the shader, it's all done there, creating a frame buffer object, error reporting, rendering to a file, what is it? Some logging stuff. And it's the place where you should add shared code. So if you think the same code will be used in at least two places, add it there. It only needs static methods because OpenGL is more or less the stage is stored in the context and not in the class. So, which food features are already using it? So we have four different features that are working with it. The 3D models, I hope everybody was in Tamas' talk. They use libgltf. And use our OpenGL context for that, but the whole OpenGL calls itself are in an external library, and it works surprisingly well. But I think it requires OpenGL 3.0, something like that. Then my 3D charts that will be available in 4.4. I will talk a bit more about them tomorrow. Sadly, they are broken on master after my last big merge before the conference. So I will not be able to show a demo tomorrow, but you can see my amazing screenshot from a few weeks ago. And the OpenGL transitions, they have been in the code for quite some time. I fixed them, so they work now on Windows, and use the same implementation for all three platforms. They should be much faster on Linux now, finally, so something usable on most machines. I ported them to GLM already, so it was just a mask the copy replace, and switched from double to float, which helped the performance quite a lot. So if you work with OpenGL, use float, GPUs are really, really bad with doubles. Please test it. I actually introduced a dozen regressions. If you know my code, you know how bad it is. So, the OpenGL canvas, that's Thorsten's baby. I don't know if he's here. It's a drawing layer canvas. It's an experimental implementation to show what would be possible. It builds already on all three platforms, but running it results in nasty crashes. I was unable to fix the first one, so I gave up. it needs a lot of it needs more work, but it would help us to improve the performance quite a bit, and especially on Mac, where we currently fall back to the VCL canvas. On Windows and Linux, we have Cairo and a DirectX canvas, which is quite fast. So, what we can do in the future with OpenGL, so as was discussed in the last session, the idea is to finish the OpenGL canvas as one part and implement an OpenGL backend in VCL, so that more or less the whole application would use OpenGL as backend, which would help especially on mobile platforms get rid of the X dependency, bring some of the workload from the CPU to the GPU that we don't use that much, and therefore improve the performance. Otherwise, I might use it for some more 3D charts. At the moment, it's mainly the 3D bar charts, which act more as a demo than a feature, but it looks quite nice, and with some abstraction it might even be possible to move some of the 3D model stuff into drawing layer or a similar library that then offloads it to OpenGL, so that we could create some easier 3D scenes without needing to worry about OpenGL, but still having the performance of OpenGL in the background. Yeah, otherwise I don't have any plans except for porting the stuff to Android and iOS, which would finish more or less the low-level work and make it possible for us to use then the same code across all platforms. Okay, that was it. Thanks. Any questions? Okay.